All right, so for our next talk, we're very happy to have Clint Efremenko of Tel Aviv University, but he's a fellow here speaking on circuits of bounded depth.
Okay, so today what I want to do is I want to give a very rough overview of what is known in arithmetic circuits, complexity, and trying to give most important problems. I'm not playing it, but I'll try to give many interesting problems for people, especially for people in algebraic geometry. Okay, so first of all, what is arithmetic circuit? So arithmetic circuit is about, assume that we have variables x1, so on until to xn. And now the question is, you're allowed to make additions and multiplications and say divisions. What kind of polynomials can you calculate fast? So for what polynomials there exists a small circuit, and what you're allowed? You're allowed to take any two known polynomials, any two things that is known. Say you have x1 to xn. Then you're allowed to take, say, x1 and add plus x2. When you say allowed, take this x1 plus x2 and multiply it by x3, and you continue this with this kind of stuff. So you can add things that is already you already computed and multiply things that you already computed. This is what arithmetic circuits is about. And usually, sometimes it's better to represent it as a graph. So you have here, say, x1, you have here x2, you have here x3. Then we represent it as a graph, but x1 and x2 here are added. And here it's multiplied by x3. And here you get x1 plus x2 multiplied by x3.
What about scalars?
You're allowed here to put. So usually it's, there are many different kinds of models that you can think about. But let's say that usually you're allowed here to put lambda 1 and lambda 2, and they're kind of for free. Lambda 3. So you're allowed to put any scalars for free. And most of the things I'm going to tell today will be true about any field of any characteristics, unless I will explicitly say that it's not true over any characteristics. Okay, and there is another. So this is the class VP is essentially all poly. Polynomials that can be computed fast. Fast here, I mean that you don't need too many such operations, and especially it means that it's some polynomial time. Some time which is polynomial dependent on n.
Sequences of polynomials.
Yes, it's all sequences. Yes.
So what's the distinction between this expression and circuits in this context in your definition? I know that there is.
This. What do you mean, like?
Formulas versus circuits.
We didn't get into formulas yet. This is the next thing I wanted to say. Next thing is what is interesting to ask is if you have some polynomial, what's the shortest length formula can be? What's the shortest length of formula that you can write it down? What's formula? The only difference between circuit and formula is that. Each time you calculate some polynomial, you're allowed to use it only once. So when you write down formula on a board, if I say want to use x1 plus x2 times x3, say plus here plus x4, and this multiplied by x1 plus x2 times x3. So you see, when I write it on board, I have to write twice this for this thing. If I would make a circuit computation, then I will compute this only once. But the difference between circuit and formula that when you write it this way, then output gate of everything will be only one. So this is like in a schematical way when you write it as this kind of diagram, then you have x1, x2, x3. When say you have here plus, when it will be complete tree. So for circuits, it may be any graph. Here it's any graph. And here for formula, it's a tree. Okay, so this class, the class of VPE is the same thing, except that instead of circuits you put formulas. And in general, it's not clear if there is a short circuit for something, then there is a small formula for the same thing. Okay, so I want to say that there are three kinds of problems that in arithmetic complexity you are interested in. Three problems. The first and most obvious one is prove lower bounds for circuits. And unfortunately, despite all the progress that we have and like all the excitement that people have about this problem, the best what we can show is n log d, and this result was probably before I was born. So it's...
What does that mean? Say what d is.
D is degree. So if you bound, so here I have to say that here degree is, so you have also degree is some degree, which is say bounded, usually it's also bounded some polynomially in n. So you can find, you can prove for polynomial form x1 to the d plus x2 to the d plus xn to the d, that the minimal size of arithmetic circuit that you need to calculate it is n log d. And this is the best what you know. And this is kind of a thing, if you know what is the Bezout theorem, it's kind of a homework exercise. Okay, let's say that to prove that you cannot calculate all these polynomials at once in less than n log d operations, it's kind of a homework exercise on the Bezout theorem. Okay, so this is kind of the state of the art on proving lower bounds for circuits. The second problem, which is very interesting, I'm giving you arithmetic circuits. Given arithmetic circuit.
Sorry. Can you repeat what the definition of VP is? How does it depend on N and D?
So VP is all sequences of polynomials that can be computed time which is depends polynomially in n and which has degree bounded also polynomially in n.
But we don't talk about time in this lecture, so you should say it in terms of a circuit.
Time means the length of this circuit is time. I mean that the length of this calculation is polynomially in n, and the degree of this polynomial is also has to be bounded. in order to prevent such polynomials of kind of x to the 2 to the n or something like this, and saying that this polynomial cannot be calculated too fast.
So an element of BP is a sequence of polynomials.
Yes.
But then this is not really, so it's a sequence of tuples of polynomials that is your work on.
You can extend it to tuples, and so I'm a little bit not formal here today, but yes, you can extend it to tuples, and in fact this is true also when you put sums here, but to prove it for sums it's little, it requires one more idea which is less trivial. So
what's the length of your
graph? Length is this definition of length, like how many difference. So how many gates do you have? It's all length of this kind of program. It's the same thing. So how many additions and multiplications do I need in order to calculate some polynomial?
That's
length
2.
What? 2. Yes, this length 2. Next question is, I give some sequence of additions and multiplications. And now the question, very easy question, do I calculate polynomial which is zero or not? Does the thing that I'm calculating now is a polynomial which is equal identically to zero or not? And it turns out this is also a very hard question. And these two questions are very related.
Could you write it down?
Yes, one moment. Okay. Does it? Yeah. So, to prove that, so in some sense, if you know how to prove that arithmetic circuits if it's zero or not, it means that you can show lower bounds for arithmetic circuits and vice versa. There is a very tight connection. I'm hiding a little bit details here, but it's essentially what it means. And the third question, you are given as a black box here some f. You can ask different inputs x and get output f of x. And you know that.
What is x? N tuple of numbers? Or
any vector x. It means x one to x n. Any like vector of numbers. And now you can calculate, and you'll get somebody will answer you answer what is f of x. And you know that f has small circuit. So, and the question is find f. Can you find f efficiently? I want to say that all these three questions are highly related and very interesting, and like this kind of questions which are interesting.
What is number three? Can you repeat number three one more time? What's the question?
Just try to write out the full question.
Small circuit. Can you find So you are given that you have a small size a circuit for some function. Now the question is how many samples do you need to make to this function in order to find this function?
And what does efficiently mean?
Efficiently mean, if it has a size, it's always like what you can get. But if you have size S polynomial F, can you find the polynomial F in time, which is a polynomial in S? say s to the 10. Can you find it in time s to the 10? No, you cannot look at the circuit. If you can look at the circuit, it's exactly to reconstruct the circuit. All this, I want to say that all these three questions are highly related.
But is reconstructing the circuit the same as reconstructing an expression for f? Are those equivalent questions or different?
Reconstructing the circuit is exactly like to find an expression for it. It's to find a circuit which is f can be written by.
Right, and then there's the question of finding an expression of f in coordinates, the coefficients of f.
Just to find the circuit, so which is because like find the f as coordinates, it's maybe. It may have like exponentially many coordinates, so you cannot do it. You cannot really do so. The question is to like write down the circuit which computes function f.
So, sorry, just to clarify, so if someone promises you that this polynomial has a small circuit and lets you evaluate it and nothing else, and you want to find a relatively small circuit,
exactly. So you don't have to find like the exact circuit, but any circuit, any small circuit which calculates f will do the job. Because it may be like several small circuits which calculates f, but you have to find one of them. So this kind of three different directions which people usually look on. Today I'm going to mostly concentrate on the problem of proving lower bound for circuits, but I want you just to know that there exist two different problems. Now, so the problem that we told that for general circuits we know almost nothing, and like there was no progress like last 30 years at least. We want to little bit relax the problem or to look maybe on different directions. So first of all, I want to say that there is a theorem any formula of size S be computed by determinant. Size S plus 1. What do I mean? Formula can be computed by determinant of size S plus 1. It means that if you have some formula F of x1 to xn of size S, then exist some linear functionals Lij. Exist some linear functionals Lij. Such that I and j are between 1 and s plus 1, such that this f is equal to det of Lij. And this is the starting point why people are so interested in, so this is like motivation for, say, for previous talk. Why people are so interested in proving lower bounds that something cannot be calculated by small size of determinant. And in fact, in order to have non-trivial bounds for formulas, we need to prove something better than n squared. So exactly where progress has stopped for proving lower bound for determinant. Okay, but still, this theorem does not give us any issue, any clue about what's known about arithmetic circuits. And in order to understand what's the relation between arithmetic circuits and arithmetic formulas, first of all, note that assume that we have such graph, and assume that it has very small depth. Okay, in this case, assume that you have any graph of depth d. When I say depth, I mean the depth is the longest path from leaf to output. Then you can transform any circuit to the formula of size two to the d. So here is the theorem. Theorem: if we have circuit for f of size s and depth d, then exist small, and I mean small, it's 2 to the d times s formula for f. Okay, and this why we are so interested, like this is the first problem motivation why we are interested to asking when does exist this small depth circuit.
So I should have asked this before, so who is this theorem due to, or is it classical or something?
It's very simple. You're just noting that instead of calculating each thing, you just write it down and you see it.
And same, this one is very, the one, the n log d is also very simple, you're pointing?
Ah, no, I don't remember, because it's two papers, like two different papers, but don't remember.
Bauer and Bauer and Strassen, it's like Bauer, Strassen, and Strassen.
Right? Yes, probably right. Okay. And so here what comes next is so therefore what's going on is that we can prove the following theorem. This theorem is actually pretty easy to show. It's that any formula of size S can be computed by formula of size order of log S. So that in fact,
I don't understand what you wrote.
What?
What you wrote makes no sense.
Is that computed by circuit or by formula?
By formula.
Look what you wrote. Any formula of size S can be computed by formula of size order log S.
Depth. Depth and size.
One of these should be circuit, right?
What?
One of these two formulas should
no,
be
no,
circuit.
No. It's both formula. L is end of size, like poly S. So with, for formulas, we can we have a very efficient depth reduction, and we can always get to the depth which is logarithmic in the size of a formula. And the question is, what happens if instead of a formula we replace your circuit?
But what is the depth of a formula? I mean, depth of a circuit, I understand, because there is a graph.
There is also the graph, it's just the graph must be a tree. It's the same thing.
Question, the depth includes both the pluses and the times?
Yes. Yep.
So couldn't the previous theorem just use size 2 to the d? It's a binary tree.
But you need also to multiply it by s.
Because there could be multiple outputs.
Yes, because...
That needs to be s to the d, not 2 to the d. Because the fan in could be s, not 2.
Ah, yeah, okay.
Not bounded fan in, it's actually unbounded.
But...
It's not bounded, it should not be bounded.
Maybe it'd be helpful to like write, just do two examples of formulas, like one where it's not balanced and one where it is.
I wanted to like to very briefly sketch these results and then to go to more.
It's a correct statement, even if it's not the tightest.
So we don't need the optimal statement, but we would like a correct statement.
Okay, so this is definitely a correct statement. Okay, and next thing that we can show is that any circuit of size S and degree D.
Degree or depth?
Degree. Here is the degree, I mean with the degree of the output polynomial.
Okay.
Can be computed by depth log S log D circuit of size so and this theorem already gives us that any formula so because of this theorem this gives us that any formula of polynomial size can, any circuit of polynomial size can be computed by formula of quasi-polynomial size. And therefore, if you can prove lower bounds on the determinant, like quasi-polynomial lower bounds on determinant, you can prove super-polynomial bounds on...
Could you just repeat that statement when you glue these two theorems together?
Theorem any formula any circuit can be computed by X log S log D size formula. So any circuit can be computed by something which is quasi-polynomial. It means that something which is which has a dependency on exponential dependency on some logarithmic power, like log to the log s log d, and so it has size like, so it has some quasi logarithmic size, and therefore if you can prove something which is better than quasi logarithmic lower bounds for permanent, we can prove super polynomial bounds for any kind of circuits. This were motivation, like this is why comes motivation for studying an orbit of determinant under a group of linear under of action of linear group. Okay, but the problem with logarithmic depth circuits, it's very hard to write them down and very hard to analyze circuits of high depth. So what I want to suggest is let's try to study circuits of a smaller depth. And so let's assume that we have circuit. So now what I want to say is to concentrate is on circuits of small depth. I'm going to talk now. Rest of the talk I want to talk about circuits of depth 3 and 5. And even I'm going to talk about very, very specific circuits. I'm going to talk about circuits of type sigma pi sigma and sigma pi sigma pi sigma. And what does it mean? It means that we have here some so say of circuits of depth 3, we have here many additions gates, and then we have multiplication gates. And when we add up them all together. So how does a circuit of depth 3 looks like? It looks like as a sum of product of Lij of x1 to xn, where Lij is any affine Lij, any affine linear maps.
You might want to put ranges for the pi and the sigma.
Okay. 1 to s and say. J goes for 1. Let's say that S and S square for the sake of this talk is the same. So this is this will be a general depth free circuit. This is how it looks like. Or in other words, what we can say. You can say that a general depth free circuit is lies in orbit closure of this polynomial if it take product. J goes from 1 to s, product of xij. If you look on this polynomial, let's call it d3, then what we say is that general depth-free circuit is lies in, or it's orbit lies in orbit closure of D3 polynomial.
Isn't this a formula also because it's a tree?
It's a circuit and formula here. When we are talking about bounded depth circuits or bounded depth formulas, it's the same because Because essentially of this theorem, so because if it's like depth 3 or depth 5, it's essentially the same. And depth 5 is, you can also, you just add here. If you want to write depth 5, you just add here products and multiplications and more indices, and you get depth 5 circuit. So it's essentially the same thing. So I'm not going to write it down right now, but I'll write it down a little bit later. So now we defined like a small depth circuits, and now the question is like, what's the power of these circuits? So does we like say that depth free circuits are as powerful as any general circuits? Or maybe not. And here comes a surprise. It turns out that if you have a small size circuit for some polynomial, then in fact you have small size depth 5 circuit for this polynomial. And here I need to be more precise what I mean small size. Okay, so here's the theorem. If size S for D. Always n here number of variables. Then exist even homogeneous. This is a depth 5 circuit of size. Exponential in square root d log s log n.
Maybe you should attribute this theorem.
Yeah. So this theorem, it's in fact, it's a long line of works. I will just say that the last state of the art is due to Tavanias. And but it's kind of here. It was like kind of long work before. Let me give a semi-proof for this theorem. Let's maybe make a break. Then I'll give a semi-proof for this theorem and try to tell more about depth 5 and depth 3 circuits.
So the Institute requested that any talk over an hour have a very short break in the middle of it. So since the Institute is wonderful, we will honor that request. A break for 2 minutes.
So usually it will be so.
Let's say x1 plus.
X1 plus 2 to the n, depth will be like n, but usually you will, therefore, usually in definition you will have to bound the degree of polynomial. So you cannot have exponential degree of polynomial. So it depends if you want a circuit or you want formula, because here the circuit and formula will be very different. Because it, like, if it's a circuit, then it's n, if it's formula, then it's 2 to the n. But usually, therefore, usually in definition of class VP and VNP, you always consider degree which has bound polynomial. Degree of polynomial. When I'm saying degree, I'm saying degree of polynomial.
So whenever you're ready, just start again. Just start again.
So sorry if it's kind of assumed that everybody knows already this stuff, and just to remind.
If I think of D and M constant for a second, the last theory. Okay, if I think of D and M fixed, then your circuit of size S. If I think of D and N like as fixed like thing, and your circuit of size S got reduced by the circuit of size X of log S. That's what square root of log S, which is smaller.
An issue if n and d are fixed, then any circuit can be calculated by something constant size. So you cannot make it.
But is it right that I also have like a reduction in the circuit size?
Once again, if you have,
you know, this s like reduces to x plus square root of log s.
But s is bigger than d and n.
Yes, usually s is.
That's why it's strange.
No, but like S is bigger
S
than
is usually
D.
Bigger than N. Like S is almost always will be bigger than N. If S is less than N.
So you get a reduction from size S to size.
No.
Because S, you're multiplying by D.
So
it's E to the square root of D is bigger than S.
Like the main factor is this.
All right, E to the square root of D is bigger than S.
Yes.
That's what you're saying. Okay. That's fine.
But that's a trick.
What
does
that mean?
I have no clue.
I can't read what's the square root type x, but there's something.
You would know the level of ignorance.
Okay, so
yeah, try to write a little neater. That would help.
It's x. Here is it's x. Here is kind of order, which means that some constant here hiding inside. Square root d log s log n. Okay?
And do you differentiate between the degree of a circuit and the degree of the function that it computes?
Yes, it's a degree of a circuit of a function, yes.
So you say
when I'm saying degree, I'm saying as a function.
Degree of a polynomial.
Degree of a polynomial, yes. So just usual degree, what you know.
And that's what you meant over here, so you
want
this.
Yeah. Degree here is the degree of a polynomial. When you write polynomial, it has degree, and here it's we are talking about the degree of a polynomial. So first of all, I want to note that this theorem already gives us a very strong motivation to study depth for five circuits. Because it means that if you can prove bounds which are better than this.
What is homogeneous?
But let's forget about homogeneous. It's some additional condition. But for a moment, let's.
But then I thought it is even for depth 4 and depth 3 the same result, right?
Yeah, right. But I want to state first this result. But you're right, but the same result calls for depth 4 and depth 3. I just want to prove them and to say a few words about how the proof works. And because this result, for example, holds for any field characteristics. But the depth tree result doesn't hold for any characteristics.
I see. But in depth tree, there is no depth. Homogeneous constraint is not there in depth.
No, in depth tree there is no also homogeneous. So, but I'll talk about this like in one moment. So what this theorem gives us? This theorem gives us essentially a very strong motivation to study any kinds of depth 5 circuits. And when I'm saying homogeneous, what I mean that every input for class gates are of the same degree. This is what it means homogeneous. And in fact, okay. So let me give a kind of very very sketchy proof like I'll give you a sketch. So first of all, what we are now assume that you have some F and you have small circuit. And it has small circuit. First of all, what we are and let's assume for that F is so always we can will consider F is a homogeneous polynomial. So let's assume here F also is homogeneous. Here also is homogeneous. It means that all monomials in the representation of polynomial F have the same degree. And assume we have some polynomial F small circuit, then one can show that there exist homogeneous circuit for F. It means that in some sense that all degrees which goes to the class gates are the same.
So a small homogeneous circuit.
Yes, exists small. And here loss is only polynomial in S and D. Now let's look on a circuit. So we have here some circuits, here some pluses, here some multiplications, again pluses, and so on. Something big. So now let's try to find each time when you have let's try to kind of cut this circuit to find all gates which has degree square root d. So there will be some say that has degree say between square root d and twice square root d.
I don't understand what you're saying.
So now let me look on all gates which has degree about square root d. So for each gate, I can look on polynomial that this gate calculates, and I can ask what's the degree of this gate. Okay? And then I'm claiming my next claim is that, okay, if I'm taking all these gates of degree about square root d, then I'm going to cut my circuit into two parts. I will have like here I'll have all gates of degree about square root d. Here I'll have some circuit. And here I'll have something else. Okay, this how our circuit will look like.
So you're going to cut in three parts.
Yes, And an issue is that any polynomial of degree square root d can be calculated by a very small size circuit. Why is it small size depth to circuit? So it's what essentially means, it means that any polynomial of degree square root d can be represented as very few monomials. So if you represent it as just as a usual way, just sum of products of xi, so x to the s with different monomials s, then the size of this polynomial, if degree is at most square root d, the size of this, it's maybe at most the number of different monomials of this type. And the number of, and the space of all polynomials of degree square root d is small. How small? Exactly what we need. It's exactly something which will be, looks like approximately x to the square root d times different poly log factors.
But what about n with no number of variables?
It will be here some poly log factors on n, s, and so it will be square root. So it's exactly like n plus square root d, square root d, right? And this is approximately exponential in square root d and polylogarithmic factors in n and in n.
So it'd be good if you went slowly through these things for people who are not used to looking at them and gave details like that.
All what I'm claiming is that the dimension of polynomials of a small degree is very small. And the number of different monomials is also very small. And therefore, any gate here can be represented as some small depth to circuit. Now, next let's look on what's going on here. And then this circuit can be also written as a polynomial of degree square root d, essentially square root d, in variables which are here in the middle. But a good thing that we know is that variables here in the middle, there are not too much of them. There are at most s of them. So again, get circuit in about in s variables of degree square root d.
Log in, you get poly log in
SU,
a bit more than what you're saying.
Yes, I'm not proving exactly the statement. I just want to give people like a feeling that why depth five circuits are so strong, like why you can in depth five circuits you don't need like 2 to the n operations, but you need something which is much much smaller. Okay. And this is essentially the proof. So I'm saying that upper part is also circuit in O of S variables of degree square root.
So where does the depth 5 come from? Looks like 4. Sum of times.
Depth 5 comes because it's sum product. I prefer to it's also true for depth 4, but I just like depth 5 more because it's a general invariant.
No, but I think the point is you have depth 2 and depth 2, but then you have to glue the two together, and that uses that extra
some.
So yes.
Where is the 5 comes? So you have 2, and then when you put together, where is the 5th one? Not
add. You have to sum up here. So, let's see.
Do you always require sums at the bottom level?
What?
When you count 5, does it have to be a sum at the bottom level?
Yes.
Oh, maybe that's it. There's like a fake sum at the bottom.
Yeah.
I have one fact. So it's true for depth 4. I just prefer depth 5 because it's GLM invariant.
We asked my earlier question. If you take the square root of d slice out like you did, how do you know the top part is only square root of d degree? Because there could be cancellation of the top. You said the function is degree d, not the circuit.
I'm saying the function of degree d, and I'm saying that here I need that this circuit is homogeneous. Because if the circuit is homogeneous, it means that you don't have cancellations. It's exactly what it means, that you cannot have large degree cancellations.
So how big an assumption is that the circuit is homogeneous?
Okay, so for general circuits, there is a theorem, and in fact, it's very simple to prove. If you have small circuit, then you can transform it into a small homogeneous circuit.
But you assume that the degree of f is small.
What?
Right? Assuming that the degree of f is small.
I'm always assuming that degree is polynomially bounded in on size of a circuit.
But you should state it, I think. You're not stating it.
F is always.
Yeah, thank you.
If you are talking about arithmetic complexity, we always have to assume, always have to bound in some way degree of this this circuit. And for general circuits, it's not a very big assumption. But as you'll see in a moment, so hopefully you'll see today, that say for depth 5 circuits, for depth 3 circuits, it's a huge difference. It's a difference between very limited circuits for which we know to prove very good lower bounds and circuits which can compute everything and can prove like nothing. So for depth 3 circuits, for homogeneous depth 3 circuits, you can prove exponential lower bounds, while for general depth 3 circuits, you don't know to prove like essentially nothing. So.
Can you repeat that? So you made a statement about depth 3 and exponential lower bound.
I will make it, but later.
So maybe it will help to give the exact quantity there for homogenization.
Hmm?
If you,
instead of that word small,
yeah,
in your sketch, the second line of your sketch,
yes,
what does small mean?
Here, the second small is S times D squared. Maybe it will help to mention that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we are assuming our polynomials are all homogeneous here.
Yes. It's better to always think of F is some homogeneous polynomial. Because if it's not, you can always decompose the sum of homogeneous polynomials and to calculate them separately. Yes.
And for depth 4, do you keep homogeneousness constraint for depth 4 or no?
Once again?
For depth 4, there is similar result for depth 4, right?
Ah, the same result holds. Actually, like I've told that depth 5 is just because I like more depth 5 circuits, but it's called for depth 4 also. Like if you erase with sigma, it's, the proof is works also if you erase with sigma.
I think it's the last sigma you get to erase, not the first.
No, last sigma I cannot erase. I have to erase. Can
I ask another question? You made a remark 2 minutes ago that you like the GLN invariance.
Yes.
Why? From your perspective, why?
Because it's actually like from my perspective now there is no reason, but I believe that it's It's easier to study things which has invariants, and you can hopefully it's possible to use it.
So what is the difference between? So you said one is GL invariant, the other is unlocked. So why is the depth five, or did I misunderstand?
Depth 5 are a GLN invariant because if you have a sparse, say depth 2, it's not a GLN invariant. Why is it? Because if you have a sparse polynomial, after making after making linear transformation, it will no longer will be sparse. So if you have, say, x1 times x2, it's a very sparse polynomial. But after making just a general linear transformation, you will get polynomial sparsity n squared. So it's not preserved sparsity. Sparsity of polynomial is not preserved by action of GLN.
So where is the 5 is GLN invariant, but 4 is not?
Like all odd levels are GLN invariant. You need this. You need the first sigma to be GLN invariant. And in fact, okay, so let me write down some formula. And the formula says the following, that n minus 1 factorial product up to xn is equal to just some sum qrn the n of so this formula essentially says us that any product of n variables can be written as a sum of 2 to the n minus 1 powers of linear forms. Okay, this is a formula. And now what I want to say is how looks depth 5 circuits. Depth 5 circuits, essentially, how it looks? It looks essentially homogeneous. It looks like a sum of product of uij of x, where product j goes from 1 to d. Sum I goes from 1 to s, where degree of uij is equal to square root. Like all homogeneous depth 5 circuit, you can write this way. Okay, because Qij may be, say, general square root d polynomial, which you can represent. So this represents some square root d polynomial, sparse depth 2 square root d polynomial. So this is how depth 5 circuits looks like. And all depth, it's not like it contains more than depth 5 circuits of size S. But all depth 5 circuits of size S can be written this way.
So I didn't understand what was the significance of Fisher's formula
there? One moment. And now, from Fisher formula, it implies that any depth 5 circuits can be written sum of qi to the power of square root d. When so here qi, here it's not the same qi, say qi prime, and here I go from 1 to f times to the square root d. Okay, so using Fisher formula, I can expand this product as a sum of different linear functions on Qij, and therefore any depth 5 circuit can be written as a sum of Qi prime to the square root d.
Sorry, the product of j goes from 1 to what?
To square root d. And this raises a very natural, in my opinion, very natural question in algebraic geometry, and which I think it's very, worth to study. And the question is, it's well, there is well known Veronese embedding, which is we have a well-known Veronese embedding, which is goes V from V to S dV, and it's given X goes to the X to the power D. Now, and the questions of Veronese embedding and rank of polynomials with respect to image of Veronese embeddings is a very well studied question, and I think it's a question which is pretty well understood. But there is big understanding there. And here, this question is essentially, we look on Veronese embedding, but now we look not from V, but we look on from S square root dV to S dV. So essentially, we look on here on all powers of polynomials of degree square root d, and we want to prove lower bounds on the rank of these polynomials. When instead of looking on mapping from v to sdv, we look on mapping from s square root dv to sdv. And the question of understanding this, I think it's a very natural question in terms of algebraic geometry, and it has a very strong relationship to depth 5 circuits, and proving something some strong lower bounds will allow us to separate VP from VNP. So if you can prove for some explicit polynomial that its rank under this this embedding is greater than...
I think you should write out the question precisely.
Okay. Question. Find implicit polynomial of high rank, where high here I mean greater than x square root d log s log n.
And again, by polynomial, you mean sequence of polynomials.
Yes, yes. With respect of
and you should explain what you mean by rank for those not familiar with the term.
What I mean by rank, it means so if I when I take rank of with respect to some variety, it means the minimal number of elements of this variety I need to sum up to get this polynomial. So rank.
So is it really SDV or is S square root of D of S square root of D?
No, he's raising. It's you're raising by the square root of D tower under
yes.
that map.
So
what I'm asking is the image, does it really span the whole space?
Yes, image spans the whole space.
Okay.
Definitely image here spans everything here. It's just min k minimum. Okay, such that f equals to sum that goes to 1 k of xi r of x.
Question. From the point of view of these complexity statements, is it conceivable that there's a difference between real and complex numbers?
I don't believe that here it will be different between real and complex numbers, but so far what I told holds for both. So far I didn't use here any place where. Now I'm going to do it. Now what I want to do is. Okay, I will give. I want to say that I wanted to say the following. I wanted to say that this theorem also, when you erase homogeneous, and you can also say when you can write here free. And here it holds over complex numbers. So it's not true anymore over, say, fields of characteristics 2. And if you can extend this result to fields of characteristics 2, you essentially will separate NP from P.
So it's not true or just not known?
It's not known.
And what was the last sentence you say?
What?
You said something before that. Separate P from NP, what did you say?
So if you can extend this result for depth-free circuits to finite characteristic, you'll get a very strong, like separating all essentially P from NP, like in you'll essentially separate P from NP if you're able to extend this result for finite characteristic.
Why?
What?
Why would you separate P from NP if you take it over FG?
Because we already have very strong lower bounds for over finite characteristics. Because we have Razborov-Smolensky, which shows exponential lower bounds for.
But they all use small fields.
Over small fields, yes.
So this one does not say anything in the Bloom-Schultz main sense over P versus NP.
What? This doesn't say anything about P versus NP, it says, but it's...
Over, but in the Bloom-Schultz Smale sense.
In?
For P and P over complex numbers.
Ah, this says, because if you can show here more than this lower bounds for... if you can show for depth-free circuits lower bounds which are better than this, it will separate VP from VNP.
So, about P and P over complex numbers. So you said that if you replace the field by finite field, then it, so in this Bloom-Schultz-Smale sense, if the field is finite, then you get the discrete questions, and if the field is, let's say, complex numbers,
yeah.
Then but this particular lower bound does not say anything about
Pn p over complex numbers?
No. Like if you can prove it over fine characteristic, it doesn't say anything about complex numbers.
So his question is, does this theorem have implications for the Bloom-Schub-Smale model, which is kind of a different world than
VP
versus the, well, it's a general world that includes P versus NP, but it does not include, it's different from Valiant world.
I don't know, so let me...
Okay.
And, okay, so let me try to show this theorem. It's a very exciting theorem, in my opinion. So, again, using Fisher formula, we can see that any depth five circuit is a following form. It's sum of Lij the power square of d minus the power square sum equals to one to s. Okay, so this is. This way we can represent any depth depth fact. Okay, and here is a very interesting fact, which let me. Dilemma. P1 plus P2 plus Pd. The power plus Us. To the power d is equal to sum of bi.
Is that all pluses after U2, or is that?
Yes, it's all pluses. So you take a sum of many variables, raise it to the power d, and you can write it as sum of products of ed of. So you can write it as a sum of products of polynomials in one variable, in variables in only ui. And I'll probably skip a proof, but I'll say proof in one line. Expand e to the power u. Just write the expansion of this, and you'll see it.
You probably want to bound how many semantics.
Yes, I want to do it. Here I goes from 1 to sd plus 1, and j goes from 1 to.
Where's j? I don't see a j.
Where is uj?
What is the subscript on e?
It's degree d. It's just some fixed polynomial of degree d.
In what alpha what is
so e has no subscript.
Yes, essentially it's
just degree d.
Just yes, sub degree d.
I can read that e of what?
E of alpha i uj.
What is alpha?
It's just some scalars.
So
alphas and betas are in C. And now, using this theorem, what we get? We have this way of representing our circuits. Okay, so this way, what we get that this is essentially equal to sum of beta I product of some polynomial A. Polynomial E has degree D. Sum of products of E of Lij to the power square root D. And the good thing about polynomials in one variable, that it has roots. This here E of Lij to the power square root D, it's some polynomials in one variables. So we can write this down as sum of bi product of.
So here you're saying the field is algebraically closed.
Yes.
Do you ever really need the full complex numbers or just algebraically closed?
Here I need that it's algebraically closed, and here I need, for this lemma, I need that it's infinite characteristic.
Oh, yeah.
And here I get Lij minus Lijk minus alpha Ijk. And this is exactly depth. So now this is exactly depth free circuits. What I want to mention here is that we have this alpha ijk, which makes this depth-free circuit non-homogeneous. They are non-homogeneous. I'm a little bit not writing here down all subscripts, but if you will do it, you will see that the size of this circuit, you will get that this degree of this product will be about what it should be, like square root d log n log s. And this something will be also of the same magnitude. So it will be highly non-homogeneous circuit of very high degree. And the good thing is about depth-free circuits, we know that, say, determinant n requires two to the order of n size homogeneous circuits. I want to say also another thing, that in general, assume that we have some non-homogeneous, so I want to say about relations between homogeneous and non-homogeneous circuits, and assume that we have some,
just try and really finish.
But I have until 15.
No, you have until 12, you've gone 10 minutes over.
Ah. Okay. Okay, then let's, maybe it's a good time to finish, and I'll try to.
Question?
So I just get with the Fisher formula, is it true that the rank of x1, the product of x1 to xn, the rank of that as a tensor is to the n minus 1?
Yes, true.
That's Ronstadt and Schneider.
Okay. Yes.
As a symmetric tensor, that's true,
as a symmetric tensor.
So you got that dip phi is not even on that called Fisher's formula or what?
Yes, it's exactly here we say to get this exactly using Fisher formula.
Okay, now for I thought for homogeneous depth four circuit there is some lower bound for determinant which is 2 to the square root n log n, something like that.
Yes, I didn't mention like
root n.
Excuse me?
2 to the square root n.
Log n also, no?
Exactly.
Not for the determinant.
But it's for the iterated matrix something.
Yeah, yeah.
For
that is for homogeneous?
For homogeneous.
Depth 4.
Yeah.
But for depth 3, nothing. Absolutely nothing more.
For homogeneous depth 3, you can get lower bound as good as you can hope for.
No, not. Non-homogeneous depth.
Non-homogeneous, nothing. No.
Nothing.
Okay. Like this for non-homogeneous depth 3 circuits, we don't know anything, and it's very surprising. For depth, essentially for homogeneous depth 5 circuits, you know much more.
Depth 4 also, right?
Depth 4 also, yes. Okay. But lower bounds for depth 5 are stronger than lower bounds for depth 3. So depth 4. So for homogeneous depth 5 circuits, but here the key point is that we are homogeneous. This what makes it much more easier. So for homogeneous depth 5 circuits, we know essentially matching lower bound. So in some sense, improving it even a little bit will already separate VP from VNP.
No, but that you can get the lower bound essentially for things in VP, like
Yeah. You can get lower. I'm not claiming that we have like techniques to prove VP from VNP. I'm claiming that you have these lower bounds for homogeneous depth 5 circuits. So we have like matching lower bounds, and like improving this a little bit will separate VP from VNP, and as Katen says that...
So the thing is that technique also gives you a lower bound for determinants. So it's really a statement about the weakness of the model, not...
You can look at... So it depends if you see half of MC of half of full.
No, because the moment you can compute determinant, then there is huge difficulty.
Yeah. Okay, and
for if you can make a table with DB4, depth 4, depth 3, depth 5, and homogeneous, inhomogeneous, upper bound, lower bound. Not now.
But it's, yes.
A simple question: why can't you just homogenize this function E elementary? Maybe it's an elementary function. Degree d, but in one variable, but it could also be degree d homogeneous in two variables. Just add in an extra homogenizing.
Okay, let me try. Okay, so this is what I wanted to say, and you can essentially homogenize these things. So you have, assume that you have here, assume that you have some polynomial depth 3 non-homogeneous. So you have some polynomial sum of product of Lij plus Cij. Add here some constant t. Then, if this polynomial, let's say that for simplicity that all sums goes from 1 to s, and j goes also from 1 to s. So if previously we had computed polynomial f of degree d, then by adding t here to a free coefficient, this will be equal to the t to the power s minus d times f. So you can think about proving lower bound for non-homogeneous depth free circuits in the same way you can think about proving lower bound for homogeneous depth free circuits. But then you have to prove lower bound for some polynomial of this form, which has t to the power s minus d times f. And it's a very interesting question how large you can take this s. And I want to say also that homogeneous depth-free circuits, it's a very natural, in terms of algebraic geometry, very natural class of, very natural variety. This is essentially studying the Chow variety. So studying depth 3 circuits is essentially studying second varieties of Chow variety, which is like very well known variety. Unfortunately, it's less known about equations of this variety. But like, I'm really think that it's like very exciting variety which everybody has to study and everybody has to know it.
Okay, maybe we'll break for lunch now, and we reconvene at 1:45 p.m. Thank you.
Oh, sorry.